Hi, this is Inky35, and I wanted to make this video because I ended up going over and I was looking at, I have seen some people that watch this guy called Jonathan Kleck, and, you know, I'm not putting him down or anything, but anyway, he's called the Jonathan Kleck. And he has this video out called Satan's Rebuilt Kingdom, Marduk Returns. So I watched this video, and this video is completely historically inaccurate. And that's not his fault. It's the fault of the writers of the book of Daniel, and it's the fault of the writer Ezra. And the reason why I'm mentioning this is because these people think that during the time of Belshazzar and Daniel 5, and this is what he's putting in here, he's also putting in here that Marduk ended up coming into Africa to claim his crown. This is so ridiculous because, first of all, Marduk was crowned when he created the universe. He was called the beloved son. And, you know, people are very, very confused as to what's real history and what isn't. And this is why I made my video series on the Anunnaki gods, Marduk, god of Hammurabi, Cyrus, and the Israelites. And I'm not done with this, but I started mentioning what was going on at this specific time, which has to do with the exile of the peoples. And in the Bible, it states that Nebuchadnezzar was the king at the time that Daniel was supposed to have existed, when in all actuality, Daniel didn't exist. And then he actually, these are things that were written later in the time of 167 and 164 BCE. Now, I know this is very, very controversial with the fact that Daniel was written during the time of Antiochus the Fourth of Epiphanes, but because what it does is it shows that those prophecies, especially the prophecies that relate to revelations and the prophecies that exist, supposedly the prophecies of the writings of Daniel, would hurt Christianity, and the fact that these things were written later. So the things that were written in the book of Daniel would show that the writer had a dim history of what was taking place during the time that King Cyrus II, the Great, came into Babylon. Now, I have explained thoroughly what was happening with the empires. And not only did I explain what was happening in the book of Daniel and in the kingdom of Babylon at that time, from the Bible perspective, I also showed what was happening in the kingdom by the kings themselves in their writings and their cylinder seals. So in the Cyrus cylinder seal that was written, of course, by the priest that ended up writing this for the king, wrote down what Cyrus had dictated to them about what happened. Cyrus specifically states in his cylinder seal, and I put this out in my Anunnaki gods, Marduk, god of Cyrus, and the book of Daniel, that he stated that Marduk, the Lord of Wisdom, was like, came in at his side like a friend and companion. And he's the one who told Cyrus to go into Babylon and to take over Babylon. And that was due to the fact of the putting away with the worship of Marduk. And so in this video by Jonathan Kleck, he's stating that King Belshazzar, which Belshazzar wasn't even a king, he was a co-regent. His father, Nabonidus, was the king of Babylon. And he states in here, because he's taken the references from the Bible, that Belshazzar asked Daniel to read the inscriptions and the writing upon the wall when he had taken out the goblets to serve the people. There was 1,000 nobles that were sitting there that they were serving, to bring out the articles of gold and silver and the idols of wood and stone and all this other stuff at this banquet that was supposed to have been from the temple of Jerusalem. And so in this video, it's referencing that Nebuchadnezzar is his father. And I have explained in my other video that Belshazzar is the son of Nabonidus. And during this time, Nebuchadnezzar was dead. Nebuchadnezzar wasn't even living when Belshazzar was in this kingdom. He passed away in 562 BCE. And his son, Merodach, was the one, or Marduk, evil Merodach, or they call him evil Marduk, but it's Ivil Marduk, was the one who took over after his father Nebuchadnezzar had died. I also explained who took over next, which was Nergal-Sarsar, which was his brother-in-law that ended up taking over the kingdom after that point. And then after that point, then we have Labashi Marduk, who ended up taking over the kingdom, which he was a young king, and he was assassinated by Nabonidus or Belshazzar. So when Nabonidus came in, he was not of any relation to the king Nebuchadnezzar, because his mother goes by the name of Attagupi. Now, Attagupi is the one who, and I should make a video about this, but anyway, Attagupi was a high priestess of the moon god Sin. So directly right here, we see that just by the relation of the fact that he worships the moon god Sin shows that he was an Assyrian and his mother was the high priestess over this area. Now, even in Nabonidus's own records, he speaks of Marduk and his August command. And he had gone and built a temple to the moon god Sin. And this is why he became had become filled with anxiety, due to the fact that he knew that he was not worshiping Marduk, the king of the gods. So his son was put in to reign over the city as a co-regent while his father had gone away. And his father had built this strange statue that the people had not seen before. So it wasn't Nebuchadnezzar, the servant of the Lord, because in Nebuchadnezzar's own writings in the Babylonian Chronicles, you will only see him giving praise and reverence to the god, the king of the gods, Marduk. He was reverent. He loved the god Marduk. He was not an evil king. Although, yes, he did defeat and take out the Assyrians, and he took out all those kings around the coastal areas and even the Jews for, obviously, from what the Jews said themselves, was from them worshiping Baal. So Nebuchadnezzar, so this is what people don't understand. Why would God of the Jews, or even using Cyrus, who the Christians and this religion seem to state that Cyrus was a pagan because he worshiped the Lord of Wisdom, and that that God used him, according to the book of Ezra, which was written 157 years later after the fact of the exile, and also written 109 years after Cyrus had come in and taken over Babylon. But they don't realize that, why would God use a pagan to punish this other nation and Israel for worshiping Baal, yet bring in a king that's supposed to be worshiping a false god, to bring him in to do his bidding for Babylon that belonged to Marduk, and to bring him in to take over the other cities that were worshiping the children of Onlil over in the land of Canaan, Yahweh and El and all of them, and Ishtar, because they were totally worshiping Ishtar. They were having sex all over the place. They had their sex cults and their death cults, because that's exactly what it was. And this is why it was an abomination. It was an abomination to the god Marduk, because Marduk is called Namtila. He is the life. He is also known to be the Lord of Mercy. He's called the Merciful One. He's also called the Righteous Son of the Sun. He is called the Prince of Peace. He is also called the Quickener of the Dead. He is the Reviver of the Dead. He is not a god of death. He is a god of life. It states that Marduk is the one who revives the dead and meets them in their grave with his light, meaning he resurrects them and brings them to his light. He is the light, and it says he's the light, and that the flame of his light shines. He is not in any way Satan. He is not in any way evil. He is a god of love and compassion. He's also a god that has hearing to hear all. It states that he has eyes to see all things, and he has ears to hear all things. That means he hears and sees everything, because he is a personal god. He is a god of exorcism, and he exorcises and cast out demons. He cast out demons, and he also talks about witches and sorcery, and that it is wrong and an abomination. There's two gods, the Father and the Son, Anki and Marduk, but his original name is Asarluhi, and he ended up getting the destiny set upon his chest. He is the one who directed Nebuchadnezzar to take out the Jews when they were worshiping Inanna in her death cult and her perverted cults her Asherah poles that were being set up all over the place. And I mean, these are, even though this doesn't sound gross, when you go into the religion, you find out, and I'm going to put out a video on this next. I just have to put all the pictures and stuff in there. And I'm not going to, you know, spend a lot of time putting pictures on this, because I wanted to say this so people understand what's going on here. These cults and occults that are studying this hidden philosophy and all this other stuff that's going on is about Inanna, which is Lucifer. Marduk is the one who slayed the dragon. He's the one who cut off the head of the dragon to destroy the dragon because of its evil. And this happened before the formation of the world with the war that was in heaven. So all these things that you see that are being placed in Revelations and in Daniel, and these are supposed to be apocalyptic things, these are things that had already occurred before man was ever created. And it's written about in the ancient text, and I've put this stuff out in videos. And so there is a huge misunderstanding and twisting of the histories that people can find in history, because all you have to do is look and know how to look. And that's what I do. I have compared this story, and I have compared the kingdoms of the kings and who the gods are over the empire. And this is absolutely and utterly wrong. This video is not correct, and I have proven it. And anybody that looks at my video about in my Anunnaki God series, and it's a good one, and I'm not done with it, even though I've been putting other stuff out because I've been distracted. But the thing is that if you look at what's being said here in Satan's rebuilt kingdom, Marduk returns, and you listen to what it's saying here, and then you go and listen to what I'm saying, you will find what I'm saying written in history, but you will not find what is being said here written in history, because this is incorrect information. This is incorrect history, because the person that wrote these things back then was obviously trying to link it to prove something with their new religion through the Gnostics that was going to be coming through into the Christianity. Because there was a lot of sex. And I also mentioned this in my second video in my series about Cyrus and the Book of Daniel. Now, there is so much to talk about with just this area of history. And this is one of the most important parts of history to explain how everything changed from this point on, when Cyrus comes in, when the Jews were returned home, and with Ezekiel, with Ezra, with Daniel, I mean, with Jeremiah, I mean, all this stuff, and Isaiah. It's important to understand the history with them. It's the most important thing you can ever understand in this area of history with this religion. It's a very deep, deep subject. And to get the full understanding, you have to know the dates and times. You have to know the kings. You have to know the gods. You have to know the writers. You have to know when it was written and why it was written. And that's what I explain. But people don't get into it that deep because they don't understand the ancient religion. They don't understand the symbolism of the religion. They don't understand the metaphors that are being stated in these ancient texts, because they're spending more time studying something that is in the Bible instead of comparing it. What they're doing is they're just believing what was written without even going further than that, just to believe so they can pick on something that they don't even have any idea about whatsoever, and it is twisted. And they, and then even those that end up, you know, trying to go against what the Christians are saying, and then they think that the Christians are lost, and they think that the Christians know what they're talking about, and then they'll, you know, people will say they're part of the Illuminati because they don't even understand. They don't even realize that they're a part of it as well, because they don't even understand the full history as either. And they're worshiping something that they don't even know what they're worshiping. And especially those that are thinking that they have found the right path. Well, there's a huge, huge deception going on. And this is what I'm going to explain to people, what's happening here. And it has nothing to do with aliens. It has to do with gods. It has to do with deities and demons. And this is what it says in history. So I plan on continuing to give you guys this stuff. And I just wanted to say this because this really bothered me to see that how manipulated this story has become and how we have the truth now, that we can find the truth because we have the great library and it's available to us right now. And it's the most fascinating thing to ever be able to have is the internet. And we can find the truth with this if you only know where to look, and you have to start from the very beginning to have the truth. The very beginning will tell you the end. Anyway, I just wanted to share that with you guys, and because I do not like seeing history twisted when there is truth, and it's the truth doesn't only lie in the Bible. There is truth outside the Bible, and you have to compare it with the Bible, and this is when you will find your truth. So I hope you guys have a great night. I just wanted to share that because I felt it was important. And I'm going to be uploading another video very soon. I just haven't had time because of the holidays and taking care of other things. But I'm going to put out a video explaining why certain things are considered evil. And but first, I'm going to explain who one of these gods are and why certain things are evil. But anyway, I hope you guys have a great night, and I will be talking to you soon. This is Inky35.